presidents from different regions of the world. It's companies that are at different stages. And maybe we could just start by having everybody introduce themselves, describe a little bit about what they're doing. Then you know, we can sort of have a discussion about what's been easy, what's been hard, how can government policy, like the U.S. government policy, help in advancing some of these issues? How can other countries' governments, because we have 20 representatives from other governments participating in this summit, how should they think about encouraging entrepreneurship? And then most importantly, how can other businesses, venture capital, et cetera, think about some of these international opportunities? So Mike, why don't you start with you and tell us, I was here in some of the great work you're doing, tell us more about it.
Thank you, it's so great to be here. One day I heard that the first startup weekend is happening in Cairo. And I was not invited, but I went anyway with my friend. I went with my friend Nihal, she was invited and she turned out to be my co-founder. And we were there just to learn about startups, meet mentors and other entrepreneurs. But it was very hard to network and meet people during the event. We felt like there is a gap between the organizers and the attendees. And then a week after, we attended TEDx Cairo, and we had the same experience. We felt like there should be a better way for organizers to organize events and for the attendees to experience events. Everyone is there for networking, connecting people, and sharing experience. So we did our research, and we were very passionate about the idea. We felt like we can do something in the event space. So we quit our jobs and we started working on this full time before even having the name Eventus. And now we have a full engagement and networking platform for events. It's a very interactive app with 86% engagement in most of our events. So we're helping people getting together during events. And now we have a great team, two offices in Cairo and Dubai, and we're working with most of events in our region. When I look back on the journey, it wasn't easy at all. It was very challenging. It was very exciting as well, but it was full of ups and downs. And we started before even the first accelerator in Egypt to start. We had few mentors back then, but now we have a number of amazing startups, a number of mentors and support organizations who are working together to build the ecosystem. So I can see the ecosystem has grown very well, but we still have a lot to do.
That's great. Thank
you. Thank you. It's an honor to be here. So when I was growing up in the rural village in Iran, I used to spend countless hours forest, collecting firewood for my parents and fetching water. And that was not just me, but dozens of other children in Africa are facing the same challenges. They are involved in laborious activities to help their parents just prepare their meat instead of going to school. So as I was growing up, I kept thinking about something that I can do to help these families have access to other alternative fuels that they can use to replace charcoal wood that they have been using for many years. So I came up with an idea of an integrated waste management approach, whereby we collect waste and then we turn them into affordable and environmentally friendly products in form of briquettes and biomass that the people can then use. And that is like a green cooking fuel which can improve health and sanitation in homes. As we started, it has been 2 years, and we have employed more than 25 people, giving them permanent jobs, and we are trying to expand to other areas of the country so that we can continue to improve sanitation, as well as providing this kind of alternative fuels, which can improve health and mitigate funding change in the country and in Africa.
Trying to get over the fact that you just introduced me. So I'm in Laboratoria. We are a social enterprise, and I started it in Peru 2 years ago. We are now in Peru, in Chile, and Mexico. And what we try to do is to go out and find talent where nobody else is looking for it. So we try to identify young women who haven't been able to access quality education or job opportunities because of economic limitations, and train them to become the most awesome web developers they can be and connect them with employment opportunities in the tech sector. Something that I realized is that when our students join our program, most of them are completely unaware of their potential, and they come thinking that it's going to be really hard to break this vicious cycle of low-skilled employment, underpaid employment, or just domestic work. But they soon start learning to code, and it's just such a powerful skill set. A few weeks into the program, they start building their first websites, their first apps, their games, and showing them to the world, and it's so empowering. And 6 months after joining, they're ready to go out and join the workforce. So we have students who get 3 job offers from the coolest companies in town. They go out, they get to decide where they want to go and work. They triple their income, so they significantly improve their economic circumstances, they start supporting their families, and I think most importantly, they start realizing that anything is possible if they work hard enough for it, no? And we have students that have gone from working at a corner shop in a slum to working at the IDB in Washington as developers, a few blocks from the White House. So really, they're an example that anything is possible, no? And they're changing not only their lives, but they're changing their communities, their cities, and I think they are transforming the tech sector in Latin America. They are bringing the diversity and the talent that the sector needs to really become a leading force in our economy. And I'm pretty sure that as we continue to grow and reach thousands of women in the region, they are going to change our countries for the better, making sure that we can actually base our growth on the most important thing that we have, that's our young talent.
That's great. Thank you for being here. Yeah. When we were talking backstage, I had been reading about this, and I said 60% of the women who have gone through this program now were employed, and I was corrected, it's now 70%. I had old data, but I think it's important to point out your success rate has been quite extraordinary already, so it's wonderful. Mark, there was a time when you were sort of in their shoes. But now, obviously Facebook's success has been extraordinary, but I'm sure that you still can connect with the stories that are told here and some of the stories out there. How's Facebook thinking about its own role in creating this platform for entrepreneurship around the world? I know that's something that you've been thinking a lot about.
Well, it's really inspiring to be here with so many great entrepreneurs. And you know, to hear about all the work they're doing, it's an honor, so thanks for having me. You know, to me, entrepreneurship is about creating change, not just creating companies. And you know, the most effective entrepreneurs who I've met care deeply about some mission and some change that they're trying to create, and often they don't even start because they're trying to create a company. Right, and you know, that's how I think about you know, my connection to all of us here is, when I was getting started, I cared deeply about giving everyone a voice, right, and giving people the tools to share everything that they cared about, and bringing a community together. You know, it started small in one university, and I didn't think it was going to be a company at the time. As a matter of fact, I was pretty convinced that at some point someone would build something like this for the world, but you know, I thought that would be some other company that, you know, already had thousands of engineers and was used to building stuff for hundreds of millions of people around the world. And, you know, what ended up happening was, you know, that no one built it, right? So we just kind of kept on going, right? I mean, people said it each step along the way. You know, what you're doing, all right, maybe college students like it, but no one else is going to like it. And, you know, know, there's not going to be any money in doing this. So, all right, so you only really do it if you care, right? If you're passionate about doing it. And then it started growing, and people said it would be a fad, and it would never be a good business. But you know, you keep going because you care, not because you're trying to create a business. And you know, then there was the shift to mobile, where people thought that it wouldn't be a sustainable business. And you know, for each of these things, the entrepreneurs who I think build things that last for a long time keep going because they care fundamentally about the change that they're trying to create in the world. And they're not in it just to build a company. And you know, I carry that with me today. You know, so you know, today we have, you know, we live in a world with more than 7 billion people, but more than 4 billion of us are not on the internet. And you know, we talk about having an equal opportunity to be able to create a change in the world, and you know, I think that's a really hard thing to do if you don't have access to some of the basic infrastructure and technical tools that are necessary to build this kind of technical products. So, you know, I kind of think about what we're doing today very similarly to how I thought about where we were at the beginning. You know, I get people all the time who come to me and say, all right, well, you're investing billions of dollars in trying to put internet connectivity in places where, you know, we don't get paid for it. It's not something that will make it